说迷人的眼睛，在我脑海里你的身影挥散不去，握你的双手，感觉你的温柔，真的有点透不过气。你的天真我想珍惜，看到你受委屈我会伤心。哦哦哦，只怕我自己会爱上你，不敢让自己靠得太近，怕我没什么能够给你，爱你也需要很大的勇气，只怕我自己会爱上你，爱上你是我情非得已，难以忘记初次见你，一双迷人的眼睛，在我脑海里你的身影挥散不去，握你的双手，感觉你的温柔，透不过气。你的天真我想珍惜，看到你受委屈我会伤心。哦哦哦，只怕我自己会爱上你，不敢让自己靠得太近，怕我没什么能够给你，爱你也需要很大的勇气，只怕我自己会爱上你，也许有天会情不自禁，想念只让自己苦了自己，爱上你是我情非得已。
昨天那个夏天，微风吹过的一瞬间，似乎吹翻一切，只剩寂寞跟沉淀。
如今风依旧在吹，秋天的雨跟随，心中的热全不退，仿佛继续闭着双眼， 熟悉的脸又会浮现在眼前，蓝色的思念突然演变成了阳光的夏天，空气中的温暖不会很遥远，说一声四季不变，不过一季的时间又再回到从前，那个被风吹过的夏天。吹过的一瞬间，似乎吹翻一切，只剩寂寞肯沉淀。
我依旧在追，秋天的雨跟随，心中的热却不退，仿佛继续闭着双眼，熟悉的脸又浮现在眼前。
其中的温暖不会很遥远，后冬天也仿佛不再留恋，色的思念回首对我说一声四季不变，不过一季的时间又再回到从前，那个被风吹过的夏天，那被风吹过的夏天。 进去，明明很想生气，却又止不住笑意。
Okay, let's go. Good morning, guys. Welcome back to the stream. We are already in week 11, the end of week 11. So today, we'll do something new, okay? Like what I said earlier, today we'll start our first day as our spy training. So very happy to see you. We only have 200 survivors here today. So half of the class is gone already. Maybe they are not chosen. They are not the chosen one. If you are here, you are the chosen one. So throughout the rest of the weeks, all the streams we'll start today, we'll start to learn the basics of Wireshark first. And this Wireshark will be our girlfriend for the next 4 weeks. And we'll be using Wireshark to do a lot of things, including how do you find out where is this person right now? What is this person doing on the network? And you can even recover password from certain website. Okay? Now, but this one is a superpower. Maybe I should ask you this one first before we start. Let's do some warm up, okay? Warm up, and then I have a poll for you here. Let's do this poll together. Okay, while I prepare, I have one friend that will join us in this stream. So we are not alone, I'm not alone here. But while I go and get my friend, you can do this poll. And then when we come back, we'll start to do Wireshark. Can do or not? Why no people answer the poll one? Not even one. My friend is already here. Yeah, 8 people reply only. Okay, we'll keep this open for 1 minute and then after that we come back, we see which superpower is the one that everybody want. Okay, and then I will see whether I can give you the superpower or not. Wow, everybody want to do time travel because you made too many mistakes in your life. Now you want to go back and fix it. Yeah, you see, actually one of the biggest mistakes that most of us did as a guy is we are not brave enough to talk to the girl we like during our high school time. That is the thing that I wish I could change. Public bank, everybody also want to clear your tuition fee. Many people want to get free tuition. Then who is going to pay me to do this stream? Some people want to get A for datacom. A, get A for datacom, and then after that, datacom is just a very small part in your life, you know. There are so, still so much to your life. It's not worth it lah. You get one A for this subject for what? You have to see far. Don't see what you have right now. You have to see in a few year time. Hack my neighbor Wi-Fi. Hey, right now, no people want to hack Wi-Fi anymore. Okay, okay. Enough already. Now, let's look at the result here. Most people want to do time travel. Okay, I tell you what. In Wireshark, I will teach you how to do time travel. But it's cheating one lah. Time travel is like, you can travel back in time, but all the people around you is still moving forward with their life. So it's not really a time travel, but in Wireshark, I can show you how to do time travel on a computer network, okay? Some people want to hack public bank. Hey, guys, sorry to tell you lah, if I can hack public bank, then I'm not here today lah. I won't be streaming on YouTube lah, okay? I'll be working with some, I don't know, black company in the underground facility where even if you see Google Map, you also cannot find me. Right now, I cannot teach you how to hack public bank, but I can teach you how to find password, okay? The username, login, account, password for some website that is not secure. That one I will show you also in one of the, in a short while. Okay, now, those people want to get A for data com, it's not Wireshark, okay? I can tell you most of the thing that you see here, the superpower here, you can do with Wireshark, you know. Of course, it's not as what you think lah, but later on you will see what I mean. But get A for datacom is not Wireshark. You have to follow me on Instagram, then you'll get A for datacom. Okay, no people want to hack Wi-Fi anymore, so the rest we don't care, okay? So now we'll start with Wireshark already. I hope by now you already downloaded the Wireshark with you. So the reason I don't put the correct link is because I don't give you the installer, is because Wireshark is always updating one. So maybe by now when you download, you have a better version, newer version. So you should always update your Wireshark one because they always add this feature and then you can do more new stuff, cooler stuff, that things that you didn't know it is possible before this, okay? So for those who haven't got the Wireshark, you go to Wireshark download page. Download it now. It's very fast one. It's not very big. Install it so that later on you can try out what I'm doing here on this stream today. Okay? And I just want to, before I start, I want to introduce you to my friend here. So this is the shark that you see yesterday. And this is my Wireshark. Okay? This is my pet lah. And he's very important. He's our special guest for this stream. So why he is here is because this one, he's like my crystal ball, you know. He know a lot of things one. If you know how to ask the right question, then you can know a lot of things. So every time I want to do something, I'll be like, okay, Wireshark, it's like a crystal ball. If you have watched Disney movie, it's something like a crystal ball. Then you just say, Wireshark, tell me whether my girlfriend still loves me or not. Okay, then he will say, okay, still love you, or hey, you don't even have a girlfriend. Wrong question. Something like that. So this one, today I will put him here lah. This is the Wireshark. Our new girlfriend for the next 4 weeks. So for those who already have Wireshark, I want you to open up your Wireshark. So first thing is, I'm going to show you the interface, what we have, how to use it first. So we want to get familiar with all the basics before we start to learn all on how to spy, on how to decode, things like that, okay? Now, first thing, my Wireshark might look a little bit different from yours because again, mine is on macOS, but the functionality is all the same one. So later on when I'm showing you something, if there are certain things that you cannot find, please let me know on the chat below so that I will slow down while you go and find it in the Windows version, okay? Now this Wireshark thing, from the name, is very cool, okay? This Wireshark. Why we call this is because when we use the internet, we have learned about the 5 layer, right? And we know that how the internet works is when we are sending a data from one host to another host, then the packet will go through the data. It will go through 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and then we build a big datagram unit. we send it to the other side. And then the other side will go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to recover the data. Okay, we have talked about this. So we know that all the things have to go through the physical layer, level 1, to go from one place to the other place, right? Now, what Wireshark is doing is, because anything you go onto the internet will have to be transmitted across the physical medium, we create some people, very smart people, they created this Wireshark to listen on the network. So we call this thing listen, means that I want to know what is going on the network when people is using the internet or using the network. So this Wireshark, formerly we call this a packet sniffing tool. Sniffing as in you smell, like, okay, what is this smell? Okay, like that. It's Friday, it smells happy. That smell, sniffing, okay? So we are sniffing on the wire. So what it actually do is, anything that go to the internet, if you know where to put this Wireshark, okay, then you can get all the packets. Now, the first rule, I have to be honest with you, all the things that we'll be learning very, very soon, it only works if you have the data, if you have the packets. So you can think, okay, Wireshark, we can do so many things. Even before I start, I already feel like I'm so excited already. But assuming that you have all the data, without the data, there is nothing much really you can do. Okay? So that is why now I'm going to show you how you can capture the packets first. Okay, before we want to do anything here, we need the data. So I will go here. There are many, many ways, so I will draw a few ways based on what we have learned, okay? Now, remember you already learned about router, you know about switch, you know about hub. So what we want now really is, if I have a network here, so let's say I have a network, so in green color, and then this one, it goes to the internet. Okay, so let's say this one is my home network. And in this network, I have a few people using the network. Okay, now you can think of this as your hostel. So your hostel could be if you are staying in Westlake, then you have 3-story. Then in every floor, you have one unified. In level 1, one unified. Level 2, one unified. This is how the Westlake hostel internet looks like, correct? Or you might have your own internet, that's fine. So you know that there will be many people sharing the connections. Okay, so now let's say this is you. And sometimes this thing happens to us. It happens that one of your housemates is a pretty girl. And for 3 weeks, you see this pretty girl is always eating alone. She never call any guy at night. So you know, this is my chance already. So let's say you have a pretty girl stay here. So this one is the pretty girl. Okay, now what you want is, maybe you want to make sure this one, she don't have a boyfriend now. That is just my guess. I want to make sure, correct or not? Because I don't want to go after a girl that already have a boyfriend, then it's not so nice lah. I know it's not so nice because it will hurt the boy in the end lah. So I don't want that. Okay, so this is just an example. It's not that I can do that or I will do that, okay? So what you want is, let's say you want all the packets here. So it means that now you want to know what is this girl doing on the internet. Whether if she's using Instagram, or whether if she's using Messenger, or whether if she's using Tantan, got or not, you want to see. So of course there are many things that you want to know. Wow, first time so excited. First time is very excited one. Okay, so right now we are not talking about what we want to know yet. We just want to say that I want all the traffic that is coming from the PC that this girl is using in the hostel. That sounds very exciting, right? So of course, now this is the diagram that is not as in a real world. If you are using Unify, it is different. I will show you in a short while. So we will start here first. Now in a network like this, if you have a switch, a router, and many devices connected together to that switch, okay? So how do you want to get the packet is, you have to learn how to do a mirroring port on the switch. So we call this a mirroring port. Okay, This might work or might not work depending on the type of switch you are using. Now, if the switch that you use right now, it supports this mirroring port, it means that because you know a switch is many port one, mark, correct? You still remember you have so many ports where you can put in all the cables, right? So you take one of the port, normally is they put in a special color one. Then you configure this port into the mirror port. So for example, you want all the traffic from this girl, okay? You can go to this port here, your own port here. You turn this into a mirror port. Now what it does for you is that if you become a mirror port, all the traffic that is going to other people, it will also send to you. The switch will also send one copy to you. So it means that one packet now, I will multiply it, become two packets. So one, I will go to the original destination. The second copy, I will give it to you because you are mirroring the packet. So you get one extra copy. And that is the first way you get all the packets that your friend is doing on the network. Now you see, in the first place, switch shouldn't do that because switch is a layer 2 device. Layer 2 is quite smart already. So I know this frame come into me. Where this one should go? Based on the destination map, I know go here or go here. But if you do a mirror port, any packet that is going into a switch, you will get one copy. So, wow, this is like really, really exciting, okay? Now, this is the first way. You can get a mirror port. How do you configure this mirror port? I won't show this on the stream. If you're interested, you can always go online and then you'll find how to set up a mirroring port on the switch, okay? But this one is not really useful for you because in the unified network, it's not in this way. So, I will show you some other way. Now, it's exciting. You get all the data, it's cool, but it doesn't mean that if you do not know how to use the data, it's also like nothing, right? Not. So if you are handsome, but you don't post your handsome photo on Instagram story, then no one is going to know that you are handsome. You need to know how to use your advantage, okay? Now, next one, this is the first way. So we call this a mirroring port. Second way, I have the something like this, the same network here. And then go to the internet. Now, this one here is our inside network. So, let's say I have the same three PC here. This is you, this is that girl. Okay, now, the same thing. What we want here is, we want all the traffic that is coming from the PC that this girl is using right now. So, how can we do that? If we don't have a switch, then the other way is you replace the switch with a hub. Okay, so over here, instead of you use a switch, now you want to use a hub. And then the same way you connect all these three devices together. And this, if you really think about this, you know this, deep down inside you know. So try to think, what is a hub? Layer 1 device. What a hub do? Broadcast all the packets. What I get, I will send it to everyone, correct? That's what we have already learned. So in this case, if you change it to a hub, in fact, it is way cheaper, and you actually get all the packets of everyone in this red color network, correct or not? Think about this. If this is how a hub works, okay? I get a packet here. I will forward the packet out to all the other ports, okay? So in this case, if you set this, change the switch to a hub, when this girl use Tan Tan, upload her new photo, hi, I'm so pretty, and I live nearby you, wow, then you must faster run to her house. So this packet will go to this hub, right? So I use blue color, and because it's a hub, it will send to everyone, it will also send to you. And with this, you already get her packet. The packet that is going to the Tan Tan server or YouTube server, you also know. So you see, a hub is actually quite dangerous, you know. It's not secure one. If your network is using a hub, I don't know lah, maybe nobody care what you do. But, okay, maybe some people care. Then they know what you are doing. Okay? Now, at this stage, of course, Okay, let me refresh this. don't know why sometimes it do this. Okay, let me repeat this thing. So I was saying that a hub will always broadcast the packet. So when this girl use any network services, the packet will go here. Okay, so when it goes into the hub, this hub will send to everyone else. And that is how you get a copy of the packet that is going from this girl PC to the server, the destination server. But in this case, you actually get a packet. And that is why, just now I was saying, hub is so dangerous if some people really want to know what you do. By changing the switch to a hub, you already get all the data. But of course, that is, you only get the data. Whether you can do something with it is another story, okay? But I believe you can, because right now you are listening to this stream, which means that you will be learning about that very soon. So here, this one that you see here is the second way you can get all the traffic from everyone in your own network, okay? Now, the next one here, I will show you how you get packet for a unified network. Because now everybody, I think most of you are using unified. Of course, what I'm showing you here, you will see one pattern. We are only able to get all the traffic from the people that is in the same local area network, okay? It is not possible yet for me to go and get packets from your girlfriend which is living in somewhere else and using another network, okay? It is possible, but it is not in the scope of this subject. And the easier way would be, you have to talk to your ISP. Okay, you see, if today you want to know, you want to get the packet from someone who is not in a LAN, who do you think have the data? Your ISP. If you are using Unified, TM will have all your traffic. If you are using Maxis Fiber, Maxis is the one who have all your traffic. Okay, now what they do with your traffic, I am not sure lah. But what I can tell you is they have all your traffic. Okay, they can do what they want. Okay, now, how about a unified network? A unified network is a bit difficult because if you look at your network setup now, you have one router and one modem, correct? So that is not two devices. You don't have a switch and then a router. You only have a switch and router that is already combined into one device. And then we always thought that is a router. Yes, that's actually a router. It's a router switch. And then you have another one, the modem, the one that we don't always care. Because that modem is the one that connects the fiber line to your modem. So normally you will have a modem. Okay? And then your fiber optic cable will come in here. So this one is your fiber optic cable. And then you will connect to this device. Now this one is a router switch. Because if you look behind your TM router, you will see there are a few ports one, okay? Normally you will see like this one. And then you have one blue color one. So this one is in the back of your TM router. Now the first few one, this one 1, 2, 3, 4, this one is for you to connect your PC. So you can, if you want the PC to go online, you just connect the PC here, okay? Now that one is actually the switch inside this device. It is it's working as a switch. And this blue color one, you will see there is one special port, blue color one. They will write something like this one, a WAN. And this one you have to connect to the modem. Okay, this cable here, this connection here is this one. Okay, so now I highlight in yellow. The one that you connect to the router to the modem has to use this one. Because this one is the one that go to the internet. And this is the router port on this device. Okay. Now, because of this, how can we capture the traffic for a unified network? Now, I will tell you two ways. One way is the scientific way, the way the pro use. The other way is like what we will do, okay? People like us. So, first way is, of course, you have to do some programming on this device. And you want to do a forwarding. It's not really programming, okay? Don't be scared of my programming. It's just configurations. But what you need to know is you have to learn how to update the firmware first, okay? So first thing, the firmware you don't have to write. It's already online. But you have to find a firmware that will change some existing thing in this device. and that will allow you to do a packet forwarding. Okay, packet forwarding by default, it is already working. Every router that you have, they can do packet forwarding. Okay, but this kind of forwarding is different. It means I want to forward from a original host to another host, and that another host is me, the stalker who want to get your packet. Okay, so something like this, if I have this device here, so 1, 2, 3, 4, and then you have one blue color one. So let's say if I connect one PC here, and then the girl connect her PC here, okay? You want the traffic for this girl. Of course, the last cable, we don't care because this one is going to the internet. So what you can do is you have to go into the configurations. After you update the firmware, you can change this thing. Of course, I cannot tell you the firmware here because I'm not sure whether it is even legal or not. So what you do is they have this option where you can do a reroute, meaning that if you have a packet one, okay, this one is the destination is going to 1.1.1.1. So let's say this girl is 1.1.1.1. You are 1.1.1.2. Okay, so you configure a packet reroute, all the traffic here, you want to reroute to 1.1.1.2. So if you do this, this one is very, it is UI based, okay? If you install that firmware, you can just use your mouse to click one. Of course, you have to type in the IP also, which also means you need to know what is the IP address the girl is using. So normally, if you have a packet going to the girl machine here, this time, it will go to you first. So before the packet go to the machine, it will go to you. Because now the router say, if a packet want to go to 1.1.1.1, you send it to 1.1.1.2, which is kind of odd. Because normally, if a packet go to .1, you should send it to .1. So this is called a packet forwarding within that router. It is supported by some firmware that third-party developer already made. Okay? Now, of course, from here onwards, two things can happen. First thing is you have to configure your PC to send the packet back to this girl. Otherwise, this girl will never ever get any data, you know. Do you see what I mean? Now, if you don't do that, that's also okay. You will still get all her traffic, but this girl will think that, hey, why I cannot go to the internet? I can see it's connected, but why I cannot go to the internet one? Because the packet, you already take it. Do you see that? So you have to always send it back another copy, which also requires some script that you have to run on your own local PC. Now, of course, you can do that, you don't have to send it back. But if you don't do this, then this girl will stop using the internet because she is not seeing anything, correct or not? So you have to be smart also. Now, this is one way. Okay, this is a scientific way that you should do it. Now, of course, if you think this is too hard or you don't want to change the firmware of the router, for those who are interested, how to change the firmware is you have to find the right firmware, go inside your router, and then there is one tab where you can do a firmware update one. You just upload the file, you click update, then it will update already. Okay. Now, the easier way, let's do it the easier way. You just use a hub. Okay. You see, this is your unified network. So again, you have a modem here. And then you have the router switch. So this is the router and switch. And you will connect to a few PC. Okay, now what you do is you can buy a hub, and then you connect this hub here. So instead of you connect in this way, you delete all the PC here, and then you also don't connect here, you connect a hub here. Okay, and then all the PC you connect here. So PC. And if you do this, then all the traffic that is coming from this guy to the hub, it will also be sent out to all the other people in the network. Okay? Do you get what I mean here? So it's still going back to the same thing that we learned, use a hub, because hub is a broadcast device. So you're going to get everything on the network. But this one is a bit weird. Then if you do this in the real network, in the hostel, your friend will be like, hey, why we got one extra router here? What is this router doing here? Then something is fishy going on, right? Not. So what I can tell is you can still use this method, but you buy a beautiful box, you cover the hub, and then on the box, you label press speed router, PlayStation router. Okay, you just put the logo here, PS router, and then you tell them, this one I upgrade one, no need to pay me because I want to upgrade the speed of the internet. If you all connect to this press speed router, your internet will be faster. Okay, so that's another cheap way we can do it lah. If you really want to hide it, and then you still want to use a hub. Okay, so that is the three ways that you can collect data. So assuming that you already know this, then next part of this stream, I will show you like, okay, once I have the data, I'm rich. Data is currency, I'm rich. But what do I want to do with that? Okay, if you're only sitting on a lot of data, then there's no value. But if you know how to use Wireshark, then you are a rich person, okay? So today you are already a rich person, not by checking your public bank balance, but by doing this Wireshark thing, okay? So guys, if you are ready, we'll go back to your Wireshark now. Okay, and before I go further, I just want to check all the people that's streaming right now. Do you guys have another class on 11? Do you guys still have the lecture on or not? Can you just tell me on the chat, please? Yeah, you guys have another class, then we have to speed up a bit, okay? I go slow because I don't want you to miss any step. Every spy have to learn from the basic, you know? Like, okay, I tell you about my story lah. Once I worked as a barista in a cafe, so because I want to learn how to draw the beautiful latte art to impress the girl that I want to go after. But end up is a sad ending lah, okay? That is to cut the story short. But, okay, when I was working there, before they teach me how to draw the latte art, they tell me that you have to learn step by step, okay? So that if your foundation is good, what you learn will be easier. So I believe them lah. I still believe them. I hope that's what they want me to believe. And they send me to wash the toilet, have to scrub the toilet. Every morning, I go in, I don't see coffee one. I only see something that have the same color with the coffee bean lah, but it's not coffee, and I have to clean the toilet. And I have been doing this for 1 month, and they don't even show me how to draw the latte art. Okay, but I still believe that in the end, I didn't draw any latte art. Okay, I just sit there and then I keep some money only, like a cashier. But what I learned from the story is everything you want to be an expert in something, you have to learn from the basic, which is why when I learned how to draw the latte art, I start with cleaning the toilet. Okay, that is the basic. So I want, when you learn this, hope that we can do this slowly together so that you are good in every step of the way. Okay? Yeah, right? Am I supposed to know how to clean toilet before I can draw the latte art? I hope they don't lie lah. Okay, now next. Come back to this. So guys, for those who already have Wireshark, restart, turn it on. This is the screen that you will see. Now, first thing I want you to focus on here, the capture part. Okay, we'll go slowly and then I'll show you the interface here. Okay, are you ready? We are getting to the exciting part already. So let me levitate up a bit. Okay, now, first thing, if there are two types. One is you are already given the packets, meaning that some people capture and then they want you to find something interesting. For example, like, okay, today suddenly, Lazada have a sales, so then suddenly the server cannot use, server crash. Okay, so Lazada want to know whether somebody do a DOS attack, a distributed denial of DOS, or maybe it's just the server cannot take it. So they want to investigate something. Normally in this kind of thing, the company will give you all the data, the traffic, then you just open in Wireshark and then you do analysis. Now the other way is you do a capture. That means you are interested on some to find out something. Of course, first thing like what we say, you need the data. Then only you start a capture. Okay, so today I'm going to show you how you can do a capture. So when we say do a capture, what it really means is all the traffic that you have, that you are using when you're using the internet, this Wireshark will make another copy. So one packet become two packets, and then they will keep this copy as a separate file where you can later on come back and do the analysis. And that file we call a .pcap file. So when you see a .pcap, something here, you see a .pcap, all these are Wireshark file, it's data traffic, okay, network traffic. So today when we do the capture, everything that you will see, all the traffic is actually coming from your own local device. Okay, it's not your friend one, it's not my traffic. Although you are watching my video right now, you are not going to get the traffic from my machines. Okay, so because you run the Wireshark in your own PC, what traffic you can get is only your own, the traffic from your own PC. Now, it goes back to the example I gave you earlier. Remember, I say we can use a hub. So what I mean is, if you want to capture something, so this is your, why just now this is what we learned. What you need to do here, you need to install Wireshark. Okay, so this one is something I didn't tell you earlier. Okay, we know Wireshark is a packet sniffer. So how, just now I tell you where you, what, how you get all the traffic, but there's one thing missing here. How do I actually capture the traffic? The answer is Wireshark. So depending on where you are, you should install Wireshark at the correct position, at the correct place. Okay. Now, next thing is, if you are okay, then you will see in the place of capture, there are so many things, you know. Now, this is something that you can show off. If your PC is a very expensive PC, you will have even more things. So this one here is all the network card. Now, remember in our first few lecture, we learned that the reason you can go online is because in your PC you have this NIC, the NIC, Network Interface Card. Now if you have your laptop right now, you can go online with the wire, the Ethernet cable, or you can also use the Wi-Fi, then you will see two here. Just like when we do ipconfig/all, you will see all the network adapters. Now this place here, it lists all the network adapters, okay? Now what is important here is you have to listen in the right interface. Okay, now if you look at my example here, of course yours and mine will be different. Now my one here, you see there are lines that is totally static, no changes. It means there is no traffic coming into this interface or getting out. Now there are certain things like this Ethernet. Ethernet means the LAN cable that I'm connecting to right now. You can see the heartbeat here. Means that there are some traffic coming in and going out this interface. Now of course if you look at my Wi-Fi, that is also traffic, okay, but it's not as many as you see in the Ethernet. So the important thing here is you have to listen at the right place. So if right now you are streaming this video using your Wi-Fi network, you should capture here Wi-Fi. If you are using your internet by the cable, using the cable, then later on you should capture here the Ethernet. Okay, this one has to be very clear. You don't want to be listening into a room. So your house, you have four rooms. Then you know that the girl is in one of the rooms. The other two rooms is empty. But you go to spy on the empty room. Then of course you cannot hear what she's talking to her friend. Or you cannot stop what she's talking. So you want to be listening in the correct interface. Okay? Now, before I click, I just want to tell you, depending on your network condition, your video will become lagging. Because what I say is, Wireshark is actually duplicating your packet. And my stream might be lag also. I don't know, I haven't tested this out. Means that it will eat up a lot of bandwidth and a lot of processing power from your machines. That's the first thing. Now, for those who have interface not found, you can close Wireshark, open again, and run as administrator. There are certain cases where you don't see any interface. Then you have to run as admin. Then you will see. Okay, close it and then run as admin. Okay, now for those who can see the interface, great. So next, before I click, you have to understand this concept called a display capture and a it's a capture filter and a display filter. Okay, now, hey, run as admin, still no interface. How is it possible? Everybody don't have. Everyone don't have. Hi, yeah, why like that one? Can I know if anybody have? If you have heartbeat, can you check? Put on the chat? Maybe it's the version problem. Got ma, you see? Nah, they have ma. Hey, how come don't have? If you're watching this video, then you should have a lot. Okay, never mind. We'll talk about this after the stream. For those who don't have, later we will see how we can troubleshoot this one. So next, let's go to this concept called a capture filter and a display filter. So I want you to know the difference here. Okay, now I think all of you know what do I mean by filter, right? Filter just means that you want to remove some things that you don't want, and then you keep something that you want. And in Wireshark, these two is very important. Okay, I can tell you, whether you are a pro in Wireshark or you are just someone who know about Wireshark, you can tell, say you know, but you really don't know. It depends on how good you are in doing one of the skill set is to design the filter. So the reason is because the traffic is just too many. Okay, right now, if you are watching this stream, this is a HD stream, full HD. Now, the traffic that you get will be a lot. Sometimes when you want to analyze, you don't want so many traffic. You want specifically something. For example, I want to check what is your YouTube password, your YouTube account password. I don't want all the video traffic. I only want the traffic where you try to connect to the YouTube, when you try to log in. So in that case, I have to filter out all the video traffic, but I only keep the traffic where you try to log into the server. So that is the reason why we want to have filter. And you have two kinds of filter. First one is the capture filter. And a capture filter is that you apply the filter while you are capturing the packet. So capture means what? Means that I start the Wireshark and later on, you don't start first. So later on, we will click on this button here. So this shark button here, the shark tier where you always see, if you are on the middle of the sea and then you see this one here swimming around you, then you know that's it. Okay, no more. The last page of your story. I hope you know that this is just a new beginning for you. So later when you click this one, it will start to capture the packet, which means it will replicate the packet. And if you don't do any filter, you will get everything. Okay, so this capture here, this capture means that you want to tell Wireshark what traffic you should save, what you don't care. Now, for example, if I set a capture filter and then I say I only want all the HTTP traffic, because you have so many, you can have FTP, you can have DNS, you can have like TCP, all these things. So all this traffic is going into your PC or going out, Wireshark will have all of them. You can choose to only want this one, then all the other one you don't want. Okay, now if you do this, Wireshark will only keep the HTTP traffic while it is capturing. So this is really good because you save your resources, your PC won't be so busy. Okay, and then you don't save so many files. You see, if you keep all of these things, this one could be like 100 gig. Okay, if you only keep this one, then this one could be like only 10 gig. So a capture filter means you want to start telling Wireshark what you want, what you don't want, when it's already capturing. So of course, like what I said, the good thing is that you don't waste so much storage keeping all the data that you don't want, and you also don't put so much burden on the network card to replicate all the packets. Okay, now, but capture filter is not always a good thing. You know why? It's because right now, I only keep HTTP packet. But what if the thing that actually I want to find, is not in HTTP. It is somewhere here. It is in the TCP. Now, in this case, gone already. The next day, when you go back to the office, you will see a new person sitting in your desk. Because your boss asks you to find something, you cannot do it. And you even lose the data because you didn't keep all these things. So that means if you do a capture filter, you have to be very confident. You have to be very sure that I really know what I want will be here. It cannot be in other places. Then only you do a capture. Now, if you are not sure, the safer way would be you will keep everything. You don't filter, just save everything. So if you don't filter, that means that you're going to have all the traffic here. Okay, of course, it is going to take up more storage because you are saving more data, and then of course you are also going to have, you are using more network resources because you are keeping all this traffic. You are replicating them by two for each of the traffic. Now, the initial part is going to be like cost you a little bit more, but the advantage here is that you will have this. So later on, when you're doing the analysis, you will start with HTTP because we didn't know. So let's say if I start with HTTP, I try to find something and I cannot do it, then I still have a backup that now I can research here or research here or research here. Okay? So this is a display filter, meaning that you will keep everything and you will only start to do the filtering when you are doing the analysis. So of course, analysis, we still need to have filter. It cannot be like, okay, now I want to analyze everything. It's too much, okay? Even with AI that is really smart these days, you still need to have something that, because AI cannot do everything yet, so you still need to have some knowledge from networking to help you to do the analysis. And that is the display filter. Means that after I have all this data, only I say, I don't want this, I don't want this, I don't want this, or I don't want this, okay? But display data is just, a display filter is just showing you something, okay? If you want to reverse, you can still always see back everything. So this is the difference between a capture filter and a display filter. Okay, to sum this up, capture filter means you already say what you want and what you don't want when you want to keep the packet, when you sniff the packet. Display filter is I keep everything and I only delete the thing I don't want when I'm doing the analysis, but the deleting is not really I delete. The data is still there. You can always cancel the filter and then you can still see everything. Okay? Now, next, let's come back to this one here. And I know you are so excited, your mouse should be already here for 10 minutes. So now we can really click on this one. So for my case, now I'm going to click on this Ethernet. So again, if you click on what you are using Wi-Fi, please click on the Wi-Fi one. So I click here. And then, now over here, before you click, you can see this. This is the capture filter. So just now I say a capture filter means that I want to decide what I want to capture. So for example, I only want the traffic for my own PC. Then of course, I can type this command here, host, followed by the IP address of my PC. So you have to find out what is your IP lah. So let me find out what is my IP address first. Now you don't have to do this. You don't do this. Okay, I am just showing you this. So now I'm using 192.168.0.113 over here. So let's say I only want the traffic from my PC, I will type something like this. Now if I start a capture here, all the traffic from other PC, you won't get it. Okay, now of course I don't need this filter because I am already capturing on my own PC, which means that all the traffic that I'm ever going to get will be coming from my own PC to some other server. So I won't type anything here. Today we won't use any capture filter. Okay, so I will just double click here and then you will see all these things. Now you see, feel like Matrix. If I move myself here, I'm living in the Matrix. Let me take this in. Let me feel it. Okay, feels nice. Okay, you see, the packet is moving so fast. And there is a reason for that. Because you are streaming YouTube right now. YouTube is video. Video is very big. A lot of data. This is why you see right now, you have so many packets coming in, go out. Actually, all these are from the YouTube server. Okay, so I will click this one to stop. If you want to stop the capture, you click on this one. Just click this and then it will stop the capture. And just like, okay, how long I've been talking? Maybe 10 seconds. Let's see how many packets I get here. Okay, you see, I can go to Wireshark here. See at the bottom right corner, packets, 3,000 something, you know. Display is also 3,000 something. So, you see, of course, right now it's display. It's the same with the packet because we haven't do any filter yet. But it's like 30,000 of packets. Just I talk 10 seconds here, I get 30,000 of packet already, you know. So this is a brief intro. This is how Wireshark looks like. Now we are going to go deep into Wireshark now. Okay. So over here, I just go through the interface here. Now, of course, if you want to go back all the packets, you can just scroll here. There is a scroll bar here on the right. And then you will see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This one is just an arbitrary label. The first packet, the second packet, and then you have all these things. So I'm looking at this pane here. This pane here is like the command center, the control center, where if you want to know, okay, I want to analyze this packet, I take from here. I want to analyze that packet, I take from here. You watch Ironman, right? So Jarvis, I take here. I take here, I pull the data here. So it's all here. It's in the first pane. Okay, it's like a preview of everything. So over here, remember we say when we talk about network is one big data. For me to send this data, I have to chop to a smaller pieces, and then I send. Now, one of this packet will be one line here, this line here, okay? This line. So one line represents one chop, okay? So you have so many chunks here, so many chops here. Okay, now, even if you don't stream, now, of course, now you see that because we are streaming, then you see so many different packets here. Now, even if you don't stream, I can tell you, you still get packets one. You can try this after the video, after the lecture. You go to stream, you don't open anything, you just open Wireshark without doing anything on the network. You will see a lot of packets one. Why? Because in the computer network, we have two types of traffic, okay? The first type is called the data traffic, which is if you go to YouTube, you'll get YouTube data. That is the data traffic. The other type is called the control traffic. It's all the traffic that is working behind that to support the network. So for example, even if you don't do anything, you will get traffic from like NetBIOS, NVNS, Link, LLDS, LDAP. So all these are different protocols that is working in the background. Of course, we don't have to care about those things. They are there because Windows or your Mac or other OS, they need this thing to support the system, okay? So that's fine. The problem with that is that it is going to confuse you. For example, now I want to analyze all the YouTube data. I will have all these weird thing, okay? All the thing like, you see, this thing, RTMP is from YouTube. Now you see, I have DHCP. We are very sure DHCP is not from YouTube. Okay? Which is why in a short while, we will learn how to write Wireshark filter so that you only see what you want to see. Okay? Now, next thing is, I want you to look at the last pane first. So there are three panes. The first one, the top, middle, and the bottom one. Now this bottom one here, you will see that they are all hex value. So this one here are the how Wireshark represent the data. Okay, of course you'll say, hey, wait a minute. Remember we say that when you send data, it is supposed to be 101010. Why over here I see something like this? Okay, you are right. Actually, yes, data is sent as signal 1010. But if you take a packet, so let's say this is a packet. Okay, maybe this. So say you say this is a packet. You want to see what is the content in the packet. So you normally you will take a magnifier and then you just see like that. Just like, or maybe you put it under X-ray. Okay, you want to see inside the content. That's what Wireshark allows us to do. Okay, and you will see all these things. But Wireshark represent them instead of in 1010. It show it in the hex notation. So all these things you see here are hexadecimal value, which is actually the same thing. You can always convert this one back to binary. Correct or not? So what you should know is this one is all the raw data before Wireshark do anything for us. Okay, this is what the packet content looks like. If you put a magnifier and you try to look inside the packet, okay? But of course, if Wireshark today only have the top pane and the last bottom pane without the middle pane, nobody is going to use Wireshark, okay? Because the best thing about Wireshark, the power of this shark, okay, it actually comes from the middle pane. And that is where you will do most of your analysis work. So what do we have here? This one here, if you follow the previous lecture on the five layer, you know that all the thing that we send is, we have all the data and then different header. So what Wireshark do for us is, it helps us to analyze this thing into a language that we can understand. Now you see, what you see here in the bottom pane and what you see here in the middle pane is actually the same thing, exactly the same thing. But if I ask you something, so let's say I can, okay, mine and you will be different, so I will just randomly take any example. So I can go to any packets that I like. So for example, I like 23. Okay, so I click on packet 23, just do a left click. Now it will show the content of the packet here. So if I ask you, tell me who is the sender, what is the IP address of the sender of this packet? Now if you just look at here, can you tell me? Can lah, if you know how to do the, if you understand the packet header, you can still do it. But that is the manual way. In this semester, I'm not showing you the manual way. Everything is done by Wireshark. So the same thing here, Wireshark will translate this into something that we can understand, which is something that you see here. And then from here, you can see, the IP address of the guy who sent this packet is 74.125.12.10. So this one here, if I click here, you see this Wireshark, what he do is he will highlight this thing, right? So you see, if I click on this one, Wireshark will highlight something like this, 45800034.70. It means that this part here, okay, I click again. This part here, the one highlighted in the middle and in the bottom pane, they are the same thing. But Wireshark translate it so that you can understand what does this mean. So you see, if I click on this one here, I click here, Wireshark will highlight some other things. So this part of the packet is translated into this information that you can understand. And because of this, we can actually do so much with Wireshark, because we can start, this is where you will start your analysis journey as a spy, okay? So this is briefly what do you have on a Wireshark. And of course, if you really follow the previous stream where you learn about the five layers, then you will understand more. But if you don't, that's fine. I will still show you some tricks to use Wireshark. So before that, maybe I will just show you straight away how to recover a password. Okay. Now, if you look at this video, in the link down below on the description, there is a link where you can download some files. Go into the link, I've already added two files. One that is named the UUM traffic, and the other one is named as, I don't know, just get the one with UUM traffic, okay? Then I'll show you something. Now I will show you how to write filter, but I don't do this step by step. I will show you as we go through the example, okay? So, are you ready? The reason I'm using that is because I want everyone to have a standard packet. If I use my one, you use your one, your friend use his one, we will see different thing one. Okay? Maybe beside YouTube, your friend got another tab, some other tube. Then of course you will see other thing, right? So over here, go to the link down below, download the file which is named UUM. So over here, this is the file name. Okay, so this is the file name. Just double click, it will open in Wireshark. Or the other way, you can just drag and drop. Also, it will open in Wireshark. Okay, now if you see this window, just click continue without saving. And by now, everyone should see something like this. Okay, so if you are here, then we can go on. Now, for those who have another class coming up, you can go first and then please come back and watch this video, okay? Okay, now, first thing, I want you to think as you are a spy, okay? That will be a good start. So think, have this mindset that I'm a spy. I'm needed by this world. I have to save the world. So now we have something going on here. You are given a set of data and you're asked to do some analysis. So this one here, this traffic is coming from a university in Malaysia. It's a real traffic. And what happened is someone reported, okay? I try to log into the university portal. For example, in Utah, we have Babel. So in other uni, they will have their own Babel, right? So this student, what she does is she go to the library, she turn on her laptop, and then connect to the Wi-Fi, like our Utah Wi-Fi. Then she go to Babel to download something. So of course, they are Babel, not our Babel. This one is not from Utah. I have to make this very clear. Otherwise, they won't pay me for the next month, okay? So I'm using UUM as example because I'm not going to UUM anytime soon. So I don't know where UUM is. Later on, we can do a Google search. Maybe we'll just search, where is UUM? Where is this UUM? This is in is in Kedah. Okay, so this is a university which is in the northern area. And this traffic comes from that unit. Okay, so again, this student, she is trying to connect, open a web browser and then go to the Babel of UUM. And then she put in her username, the student ID, put in her password, and then she log in. Now, after a while, she realized that her password is posted on everywhere. Everybody here in the campus know what is the password of her student account. Wow, this one cannot lah. Especially like people like me who don't know about security. My Facebook password is the same with my Instagram, is the same with my Weber portal, all use the same password. So once my password is discovered, you can use all my other services, you know. And this is what happened. So today, what we want to do is, we want to find out, first thing is, what is the password? How can people know the password? And then in the next stream, I will show you how you can do this. How can you find a password, okay, for a website that's encrypted? So to make this clear to you, this traffic, I have it, I capture it. It's not me. Someone else capture it. When this student try to log in to their Weber, which means that I can tell you the password is somewhere here. Now our job is to recover the password. That is the first thing, okay? Because we are bad people. Why would I help you? I just want to know your password. No lah. I mean, the thing is that in security, you have this thing called the blue team and the red team. The blue team is the good people. The red team is the bad people. Okay? So which team you want to be in is really up to you lah. So right now, what we want is we want to do a capture. Now, before that, I want to show you how HTTP works. Okay? So let's go back to this. Let's talk about the concept first. So right now, this is the student PC, and then this is the server. So maybe say this is the Babel, okay, this is the server, and this is a web server. So this student here, she put her ID, send her password, and then here you log in. So the traffic that you see now currently, all the green color one, come because of these actions, okay, these network actions. Now, after this one, okay, let me see. We have to understand how HTTP works because this Weber is a web. So we know web is based on HTTP. So what actually happened is that, okay, in a HTTP protocol, there are this thing we call methods. Methods is, you always find this when you do analysis, is how the client, the web client, want to talk to the web server, because there are a few things you can do. You can go to a web server and you get a website. You want to get something. Or you want to upload something like Google Drive. You want to upload something to Google Drive website. So you can take or you can give. So for HTTP, it's like this. If you want to get something, you will send a HTTP request. and then you will get the HTTP response. Now, if you check on this one here, this one you will see the method is a GET. Okay, now this response here, I use green color, this is a GET. Okay, when you send something to the server, we call this a POST or a PUT. Okay, so this one is in blue color. So to make this simple, because this is not a website subject, I don't want to go into detail of this, but at the minimum, we need to know this. So when you send some data to the server, you are using the POST request or the PUT request. Okay, when you get something from the server, you are using the GET operation or the GET method. So all these things, we call them a method. So which means that when this student, she type in student ID and password, this thing have to be sent from her PC to the server so that the server can log in, can check and then log her in, right? Now that password here will be sent here. So later on, based on this concept, we can go and find out where, which packet among all the packets that we have, which one contain the password and what her password is. So let's go back. No lah, just half, give me 15 minutes more, okay? So now, over here, we're going to work a lot here. So this one is a display filter. Remember, I say there are capture filter and display filter. Now, we will be using the display filter. So it's something like, it's not programming, but it's syntax based. You have to know what you want. So for, I can type many things here to filter out things. Okay, so for example, you see, here, look at this part here. Before we do anything, the total packet is 3836. Okay, now display is 3836 means that you see every packet. If I do some filter, like maybe I just want HTTP. So the first thing is you can type the protocol name. I press enter, then you will only see all the HTTP traffic. Now you see here, all the packets is about 4,000, but I only see 26 packets because among them, there are only 26 HTTP packets. Okay, you can always backspace, remove the syntax or the filter, press enter, then you will see all the packets again. Then of course, if you only want to see TCP, you can just type TCP. So what I'm doing now, first thing for you to learn today is, you can always type in the name of the protocol you want to see. Okay, so if I want TCP, I'll just type TCP, and then you will see that now I am looking at about 3832 packets, which is like almost all of them. Only 4 packets are not TCP, which means what? Which means they are UDP, because you can either have TCP or UDP, right? Now, of course, I can also do something like this. I want to check DNS. I type DNS, then oh, I only have 2 DNS packets. Okay, now I can also type DHCP cannot. So I can also type something like maybe ICMP. Nothing. Means that no people is trying to ping anyone. No ICMP. I can also want to find DHCP. DHCP is the one that you get IP address, right? Now, one trick here. For this Wireshark, there is no DHCP. If you want to see DHCP traffic, you need to filter for BOOTP. So this is the right syntax. Okay, I will zoom this in for you. But of course, you don't see anything here because there is currently no one is asking for any IP. Okay, but this is the syntax if you want to find DHCP packet. Okay, Now, of course, you can keep on trying lah. You can try ARP or no ARP. So, of course, this one, it depends on how many protocol you know. What else do you know? We have learned what? IP protocol. Then type IP, wow, so many IP. Okay, in fact, all of here is IP because this is using an Ethernet network. So, you see over here is all IP packet. Okay? Now, of course, I can also do a condition here. So condition means that I can go to the place of filter and then I want to see HTTP and I also want to see DNS. So I can use the OR. So if you are HTTP or you are DNS. So I can do something like this. HTTP or DNS. Now, if you press enter, then you will see all the HTTP packets together with the DNS packet. Okay? Now, of course, you can do other type of condition like and. So, for example, I want all the TCP packet that is also HTTP. Because you know, HTTP is what? Port 80, web. Web is always using TCP one. But there are other applications that is also using TCP like FTP, SMTP. Now, in this case, we only have web traffic, so you won't see any difference. But if you have a very big capture and you have so many different traffic, but you only want TCP and HTTP, then you can do something like this. So it means that I want to see the packet if only it is using TCP and also it is HTTP. So I don't want to see anything that's using TCP, but it is something else. Then I will type this. Okay, if you press enter, then you will see all the HTTP packets here, which is again still the same 26. That means this filter doesn't change anything because in this capture that we just opened, there is only HTTP that is using TCP. Okay, so that is what we say, how we write a display filter. Of course, display filter can be very simple, it can be very hard, okay, depending on what things that you are looking for. Now, for example, in this case, I have a few people talking, okay? I can also want to say, I only want to see, okay, now let's take a look here. I have 172.16.20.130, okay? And then I also have 58.26.137.16. So maybe we have more than one host. Of course, you have more than one host. I don't know how many people is talking here. Okay, now, but let's say, but I know one thing. I know that one of the PC here is having 172.16.20.130. So I can do something like this. I only want to see all the traffic that is sent by 172.16.20.130 to someone else, to who I don't care. So of course, you can do something like this. You can do ip.source. Okay, equal sign 172.16.20.130. So this is the syntax here. It means that I am trying to find all the packets with the source IP address that is 172.16.20.130. Now if I do this filter here, you will see that now Wireshark will show me all the packets that is sent by this guy to 58 or something. Okay, now of course you can also do something like, I want to know all the packet that is going to some people. So I can change the IP here. This one here, ip.source, I change to ip.dsd. Okay, this. Okay, so it means that the IP and the destination is 172. So over here, we are trying to see all the packets that is going to 172.16.20.130. And you will see, yeah, that's correct. So now you will see all the packets. You see, all these packets are sent from 58.something to 172.16.130. Do you see that? So that is how we can play with filter. And really, I cannot show you everything because if I can, I won't be sitting here again. But I will show you what you need as we proceed throughout the exercises now, okay? Now, I won't show you any other syntax as of now. We'll just go straight into this packet capture file. And we want to find out among all these 3,800 packets, which of these packets contain the password for this student, okay? Now, of course, if I don't do any filter, okay? Then I will have to sit here for 2 weeks and then I have to check all these packets one by one. So you see, you can actually double click on this packet and then you will open one extra thing, extra window. And this is where you can analyze the packet one by one, one packet after another. So what we want here is I want to know which packet here. I already tell you one of the packets contain the username and password. So which packet have it? Okay, you have to check one by one. Got or not? Don't have. then open the second packet. Got or not? Don't have. It's not that fast. Not. I'm already speed up by 10x. Okay, so it's difficult. That means you need to learn how to do filter. Now, the trick for this one is, we know that all websites use HTTP or HTTPS. In this case, it's HTTP. So we will just apply the first filter HTTP to delete all the rest of the thing that we don't want. And if you do that, you will only see all the HTTP packets here. Do you see that? Now, in this case, you see now the display is only 26, which means that instead of working with about 4,000 packets, now I only need to analyze 26 packets. So this starting from here is really not too hard. I can open one by one. And then I see, got password or not? No. Then I go to the next one. Okay, I can do this one by one. So, of course, okay, hold on, I have to find. You can do this one by one, it's okay. But do you think there is a better way? Now, the better way is, of course, you have to understand how HTTP works. So, just now, we have already learned that the HTTP protocol is actually based on methods. And if this student is trying to log in, most likely, I am not saying definitely, but most likely, the packet, the password should be in a packet that is having a post or a put as the request method. So in this case, you can further filter them by maybe, I'm not sure whether it was, I'm just trying, http.request.methods. Okay, now this is the syntax that we are trying to use. HTTP, and we want to know the request type, which is the method equal to post. So if you type this http.request.method equal, which is whether this is equivalent to, and then you have to open two quote post and then close it. So I'll show you the full command again. HTTP request post. Now, if you filter this correctly, then you will get only one, which is really easy now. So I will just open this packet. Let's do some spy work here. So of course, if you are not familiar, we are new here, then you will start one by one. But one trick for you is you always start from level 5 to level 1. So the upper level here is HTTP. Then you just go line by line and then you read. So if you keep on doing this, you can expand this one, expand, okay? Then you see even more. Ha! Gotcha! So this is... See, what is this? What is this? How can this thing be here? This is so dangerous. So you see, what happened here is that we actually find out the student ID of this student is 1054. And her password is, why me? Mengapa saya? Okay? Why me? Why you want to hack me? I don't know lah. This one, everybody have your own reason, but what I want to tell you here is, you see what we see here. Do you think you should see this? Now, let me ask you the same question. Now, before that, let's go back a little bit and just summarize what you've done here. So this student logged into Weber, and it happened that the web server is not encrypted. So it is not using HTTPS, there is no SSL here, which is why when I have this packet, I can easily open this. I can easily go inside, check, do analysis, and if I'm lucky, I can find the content. And in this case, it happened to be what we want, your username and password. Okay? So of course, when you go to the lab, you will do this exercise again, and by that time, your tutor will help you if you cannot find this packet. Okay? Now, a better question for you is, do you think that if today you come to Utah, you log into your Weber, I can do the same thing. And then in a short while, I know your student ID. I know your password. And then I can help you to register your subject next semester. Do you think it is possible? Okay. For that, I will answer that questions on the next stream. So for those who are interested to know whether you can have a chance to know the student ID and the password of the girl that you have been stalking for so long, since your foundation, until now. Then, join me back on the next stream. I will tell you whether it is possible or not. I'm not saying it is definitely possible, but I will show you some of the tricks that make it kind of possible. Okay? So, we'll stop here today. I hope that you start to feel like you are a spy already. Of course, you're still a junior spy. And throughout the next 3 weeks, you will still be learning a lot of things like this. And I'll show you how to crack all these puzzles and challenges together. Okay? So, until then, if you have any question, please drop it on the chat. If you don't have, see you on the next stream. Peace out. Happy Friday. Bye-bye.
Cheers.